Welcome back to Sky Factory 3. Night Wrath here, googly eyes and all. It seems like I always have googly eyes. Well, I don't want to spend a lot of time messing around staring at my face. I've done a lot of updates, a lot of building, but I figured out some things and I want to show you what I learned. First things first. If you notice, everything up here has been moved and place somewhere else. You've also noticed I have a system set up here for auto crafting. Well, not really so much, but I got the refined storage working pretty well. Let me first show you where everything is and what it does. And I'm gonna go through it kind of slow just so you have an idea of how I built it and what it's doing. We're not gonna go in here yet, but outside here is where I set up my Mark II furnaces, lava generators rather. It's the same process we had before. We have a tier 5 generator for cobblestone, and it's making plenty of cobblestone. If I click on it, you'll see that I grab a block of 64 just like that. So there is a backlog. My power is running as it should. I have a lot of things actually on the grid that are running right now, and we'll see that in a moment. I've changed all my power cables. Where are they? Here. No, in the other side. Here. I have a main trunk now, and each cable supports 20,000 RF. The red ones supported roughly, what was it, 640, I believe? 640. I did that so if I like expand this area, this pipe won't be the restriction, because each one of these furnaces will put out 640 RF. So that red pipe would only support really one furnace at max load. That would cause a bottleneck. So what I did was I did the 20,000, which would support a maximum of, well, 620,000. You do the math, how many furnaces that will support, I'll figure it out later. But I'm sure I can get this whole row done as needed. Once I expand these to Mark IIIs, I still should be okay. I had to, you cannot join two different types of cable. So I had to put a power cell. Yeah, we'll talk about that in a second. Had to put a power cell in place to filter out the power. And you can adjust this power cell just by, I think it's shift clicking. I'm just going to click on this. I can't do it while you're flying. Nope, can't do it right now. Let me try this side. Here we go. Maybe I used a wrench. Maybe I just left clicked it. Nope. Right clicked it. Nope. Now I can't remember how I controlled this. Control click. Nope. Nope. Left click. Nope. Well, there's some way of doing it. I might have used a wrench. Very possible I used a wrench. Let me go to configuration mode real quick. I don't know how I did it. Well, that's just not good for me, is it? We'll make another one and try to figure it out. That's a power cell. I need to place one down anyway. Let's see if I have any more in my inventory. Power cell. I do. I have one more power cell. Let me grab a card. Show you how these things are used. And I'll show you how I did that in a few minutes. Let's get out of here. You found a place for this power cell. Need where I have some energy conduit laying around. Is it over here? I believe so. Something needs energy on this side of the map. There we go. There's energy right there. So I'm going to drop this. Let me get a conduit as well. It needs to be the big conduit based on where we're sitting. That's not what I wanted to do. I need to access my crafting grid. Conduit. You know, I thought I knew what I was doing, and I clearly don't. Let's just grab two pieces. Like I said, we'll get into what I just did by accessing this. So if I right-click this, nope. Maybe it is a wrench. Let me check for a wrench. Yeah, I think it was a wrench. The Yetta Wrench? That may be what it was. Let me see. The Yetta Wrench does it. That's it. So you must make a Yetta Wrench to do this, to adjust if you want input or output or nothing. So you would right-click the side of the power cell that you want to use. Again, it's called a power cell. Let me get rid of this. Go grab it. And can I get it back? Really? No? There we go. Let me grab my cobble, put it back in place. Amount of cobble, of course. We'll get there, guys. We'll get there. I built this a few days ago, and I kind of forgot how I did it, because I've done a lot since then. And I didn't want to play off stream or off video, but it took me a while to figure this out. So what you do with these power cells is, when you place them down, it's going to ask you what net, they're wireless now. So when you place it down, it's going to ask you for a link card. Now this link card is link one, and you have to make a blank one, put it in here, and make a link right there. So you click there and put it there. And I don't have any blank power cards to show you. Let me go ahead and craft one real quick. I think I can craft one right here. Is that how you do it? Nope, I need to do it in this screen here. Okay, so I click here, there, there we go. All right, this power card is not linked. Let me put it right here. It's unlinked. So this is not part of any network, technically, but it's full. So to link it, I would have to put it here, and then say I want it to be on this network of one. So now this should link. I think it should. All right, now it linked. You can shift click it when it's there and it matches this link ID. Everything this link ID is now gonna be on the same power grid. If you notice, this power now holds is 50,000. It was 250,000. These are technically multi-blocks, but they're not. You can put them anywhere you want to give power, and it will give a device power anywhere in your area, which is neat. It's a pretty cool battery. So once you link it, each one holds 250,000. Let me go ahead and grab that real quick. Each one holds 250,000. But if you place it down, because I have two, you now see it holds 500,000. And it's cumulative. I could have 20 of these blocks and have a huge vat of energy. All right, so there's that one. Let me go ahead and get rid of this. We don't need to look at that no more. Or this stuff. Okay. Let's go downstairs and see what we did down here next. And again, sorry for the confusion, but it took me a while to figure this out. I've moved my conduit, my drawer, my compacting drawer to over here, to where this is where I'm making the eventually octuple compressed cobblestone. Right now I have a total of two sextuples. It's been running for quite some time. We saw it last time, it's just screaming through trying to make this achievement work quite some time. And we discussed this, I think video or video before last, how we did this with the filters and stuff. So if you haven't seen it, I'm not gonna show it again here, but I made a more linear build. All right, behind this wall says Danger Uranium. I replaced my, you can't see from here, but I replaced my crucibles. And they're all behind this wall, hidden away where I don't see. I have about eight of them. And it's taking cobblestone out of a tier 5 cobblestone generator dedicated just to this process, making lava. And that lava is being fed outside to my lava generators. Behind here, I have a single, I have a single fluid tank. And it's being from two different locations I'm sucking lava out of. From this side I'm pointing at right here is outputting directly into this stone barrel. And from here is outputting directly into this stone barrel. This stone barrel is making obsidian. That's all it's doing. This stone barrel here is making endstone. And you should see it in a moment. It just did it. It just happened so fast we missed it because it's instant. And to make end stone, you just put glowstone into a lava bucket, basically, and it makes it. I'm getting the end stone, and I am crushing it, and then I'm sifting it to get draconium dust and shulker pearls and things like that. So basically, I don't even need to go get this, kill the shulker stones or pearls in the end, because I'm farming it right now. I've got these conduits taking it out here and here. This is the obsidian, and it just follows a conduit back to my dwarf controller. I moved my soul sand production to here. I don't need a lot of soul sand, but because it doesn't cost me any resources, all I'm doing is just adding water from Pam's Harvest Craft like before, the sink. Throwing in some sand that have extra from this row of crushers that we saw me do last video, and then just taking this little sand out of here and putting it back in my drawer controller. I did expand this to kind of account for the extra resources I was making. And I only have 4 sifters running right now of the 6, so I might end up pulling these last 2 up. But we'll see. This crusher, this hammer's not doing anything either. This guy is working just fine. So you saw part of this last video, I just basically consolidated it, made it all into one room, and have this door right here for access. I may change it. I don't know. I kind of like the fact that it's under the base. I don't see it. Now back to the conduits. Because these guys don't require a lot of power up here, 640 RF per tick is more than enough to run the refined storage right now, as well as the farmer, and that's about it. Up top, and actually I cleaned my pipes up, kind of made this thing all surrounded, so it's pretty much all you see. Once I'm happy with the design, I will close the entire thing in and never look at it again, I hope. That freed up a lot of space for everything else up here. I planted a mineral tree in this spot, because that right there under this trunk is my very first piece of dirt. So I want to kind of save that. I don't know why, I just wanted to keep it for like reasons. This farm is still trucking along. You see I have 11 blocks of Supremium in there, but in my storage unit, I have 121 blocks of Supremium. Tons. And as for draconium, have 140 dust available to me and 516 ingots that I've already made from that endstone crushing. I don't know how much I'm really going to need for in-game draconium, but I'm pretty sure 516 ingots should be enough to get me about where I need to be, but it's going to keep running. All right, let's talk about refined storage. It's not fully set up yet. I still need to add the furnace to it and things of that nature, but right now, this is now set up. So I'm kind of go over it again briefly. What's in here? That, gotcha. You have to have a controller. It has to be hooked up to power, as you can see down there. But that's the only thing that needs the power of this system. The rest you gotta connect with cables to make sure it's working. Ignore the wireless transmitter for now. We made the disk drives, and just for the sake of space, I made 8 64K storage disks. We saw that before. They're only 10% full because I'm using my storage drawers as really my resources where everything's stored at. I eventually will move these guys and hide them underground as well. The crafting grid we discussed, this is where you craft everything in and make your template and make your where you craft everything basically. This is the pattern grid. This is where you would go to make a pattern. You simply tell it what you want to make. Let's say if I wanted to make, I want to convert iron ore, let's say I want to make sticks. How about that? Sticks. I would choose that I wanted a stick. Why is that not showing up over here? Oh, I know. You have to tell it you want the search box to be JEI synchronized. So get rid of this. And get rid of this. Now, the JEI is now synchronized right here. I tell it I want to make a stick. So two pieces of wood will make four sticks. I'm going to make that pattern. I'm going to get that pattern and put it right there. Now I need to make wood too, right? So I need a pattern for that. How would you make pattern? You would do this. Move the item to the crafting grid. Now I want to tell it ore dictionary. What this means is any combination of wood will make the planks. So let's try it and see if we can get it to work. All right. So now I'm going to place these two patterns, and you hold shift, it shows you what they are, into my crafting grid. I'm going to tell it to display only craftables, and it's not working because it's in the wrong place. Let me grab these out of here. God, I feel so dumb today. Pattern. I want the stick pattern, and I want the wood pattern. There we go. All right. These actually have to go to a crafter. And I don't have a crafter here for this. So let me, wait. I don't have a crafter up here. Let me get a crafter. Let me go back to normal. I don't have a crafter. I thought I made one. All right. Let's just practice this then. So I need a Z-Logic controller, which requires this. And no, this is the wrong crafter. This is the crafter I want. I'm missing one item. What are we missing? We're missing the construction core. Let's make that. Now let's try it. Now we have a crafter. Okay. I'm going to put this. What is this? A table. I'll put the crafter up here. I think it should work right there. I need to use my wrench for the output. I need to rotate the output to go where it's straight down. Nope. Rotation. There. Now the crafter is pointing straight down to this device here in the pattern grid. Well, that's not where I want it to go. I want to move the pattern grid and the crafter. The crafter needs to go pointing to the crafting grid there. So let's see. I place this like that. I want to rotate it. There. Hopefully that should feed into here. I think it does. Should. Okay. And above it, I'll put the crafting grid. Okay, let's try it now. So the crafter, I'm going to place the sticks in here. And the patterns. Let's see if this works now. Still not showing, is it? Oh wait, nope, still not showing. I might need to put a cable behind it. And I can't because of that. Let me grab a cable. You know, I could do the simple things, you would think. I mean, the harder things I have working, but the simpler things just don't seem to be working for me. Let's see, cable. Do I have any cable in here? I do. Let's grab some cable. Let's see if this works. Is it visible now? I know it's ugly, but no, it's still not working. It's showing me. Or maybe I can't craft it because I have it in my inventory. Let's try this. Let's craft 64. Start. There it goes. Okay, I had it right. Because I already had it in my inventory, it wasn't going to show me I could craft it. So it's just going to give it to me and tell me I can craft it later. So that's what it boils down to. It was set up right the first time. So if you don't have something, you can then craft it. I don't know if I can do solarium. I'm not sure if I still have it set up. Let's try it. It looks like I do. Let's look at the menu. It says processing. Okay. It's actually making it. Solarium is over here in the alloy smelter. It automatically gave it the materials it needed and is pushing out now into my system. I have the crafting pattern in here. So for every item you want to do, you have to have a crafter attached to it. Now, every pattern in your crafter has to be different. You don't gain any use or special ability by having the same patterns in all your crafters. I found that out. I was trying to make solarium in all three crafting stations at one time, and it would only grab from the first available one and only feed it to there. So that's one thing I found. Now, there's no way around it. I don't know. That's all I found. Now, I wish to show you the designs for these guys, but I guess I could show you a few things. I'll just show you refined storage. Just like that. All right. So we did the controller last time. We did the grids, the crafting grid, the pattern grid, the fluid grid, the crafting monitor. We did all that. You need a processing pattern encoder. This is one thing you need to make ore with. You have to put, so let's say I wanted to make smooth stone in a furnace. Well, now let's say I wanted to make solarium. Where is it at? Solarium. Let's say I wanted to make solarium. You can't manually craft that because it requires a soul sand and a gold ingot in an alloy smelter. What you do is you come over here, you make a processing pattern encoder, and you put in what you want. So if I wanted to do something that I could not craft by hand, I would find the pattern. So in this case, let's say I want to make what's something we can't make by hand? We can't make iron ingots by hand, right? So I get the pattern, I go to furnace, and I would add this. So it will take crushed iron and make it iron ingots. It now knows if I make this pattern, I'll have the pattern. And if I click this button here, it'll put one of these here. I would take that and I would put it in the crafter attached to my ultimate furnace in one of these slots. Then when I send a command from my crafting grid to the furnace, it would automatically do it. The reason the furnace is not hooked up yet is because I need to get it set up where it only accepts mini coal, because I don't want to, it burns so fast. I don't want to burn pieces of coal or blocks of coal here. Let me get a drink real quick. My throat is killing me tonight. Sorry about that. And the furnace only accepts input from certain locations and output. So if I had everything coming from the top, it would go in this spot. The back is where you put the coal, and the bottom is where the output is. So I haven't wired this up yet. I will later. The wiring is another tricky situation. All right, on the backs of these guys, you have to have regular cable on your crafters, just regular cable, to connect to your main system. Have it on both sides. I also have my solderers the same way. On the outputs of these devices, like your slice and spice, which I can't get to work yet, like the sag mill, the alloy smelters, let me go over here. You have to go into configuration menu. You have to tell it that you want to push your stuff out the back, and you want to pull your stuff from the top. If you notice, the top is blue, it matches the word pull on the bottom left-hand side. Here it shows the output is push and it's orange. You have to configure this just by left clicking the way you want it to be. All right. Now behind here is an importer. You have to have the importer to import the output of your machines that you're sucking from, basically. And then it brings it back to your crafting grid storage controller per se, once it's finished making the item. The solderer was driving me crazy because what was happening was it would put items in here and when I asked it to make something for me, and immediately sucked them out when I had it sitting right here. Well, the solderer has no customizations. I found out that you had to go underneath the solderer. Here we are. And you put your importers underneath the solderer. And again, connected by cable back to my crafting solution for the output. So these guys are working too. I just need a ton more patterns. I just started this working honestly 30 minutes ago. And I said, you know what? Before I go too much further, I need to do a video because I've done so much. But these are some things I struggled with trying to get the outputs in the right locations. The first thing was the conduits. So let me think if I've missed anything so far. All this was simple to set up because it's just common sense conduit. You set your import export. We've done that 100 times. The problem I had was getting this refined storage system to work in auto crafting mode. So let's see what we can auto craft, for instance. Maybe there's something in here I can auto craft that I don't already have tons of. Only craftables. So improved processors. Let me grab these out. I want to make an improved processor. Let's say I want to make 64 of them. I hit start. It tells me my items are available. Let's do it. So now it's going to start crafting. Now it takes a while, but you'll see it going. In fact, the crafting monitor is showing that it's beginning. It shouldn't take much longer for one to pop up here. There it goes. One just popped up. Let's go see where it's making it. It's making it in my solderer. It put the items it needed right here. I need more printed improved processors, clearly. And it's doing the output, and it's immediately putting it back to my system. I have a crafting pattern that I made over in my processing pattern encoder. And let's go back into that for a minute. How much time do we have left? Oh, I don't want to run too late. All right. A few more things I want to show you. Processing pattern encoder requires just the basic machine, casing, furnace, so what? Very easy to make. What else did we make? You've seen the solder already. Yeah, you've seen that. All right, and the power cell, let me show you that real quick. We talked about that. We made a power cell earlier. I made a regular simple power cell, which is just a machine frame, redstone, then the quartz and diamonds. I thought I made one of these, but I didn't. It's just a simple power cell. I think they're the exact same. Oh no, this one holds a million. I didn't make that one. I made the simple one. I don't know why I didn't make this one. There's no reason why I didn't make this one. I could have. Oh, I can upgrade the simple power cell to this one very easily enough, so it's not a big deal. The advanced power cell is a whole different other story. It needs dimensional shards, which are only found, I guess, in a loot bag, the epic one. So I'm not gonna worry about those, even though they do hold 4 million RF. I'm not gonna worry about it. And the power cell card is just these items to make the power cell card. All right. Now you notice me walking around here with this in my hand, a wireless grid. It enables me to craft things or grab things from my crafting station, just like this. I can even craft from here if I wanted to. Check that out. Wireless grid. Now, the wireless grid's a little bit more of a pain to make. It took me some time because it requires quite a few things, but first I'll show you the wireless grid. Right there. Requires a grid, ender pearl, quartz rinse iron, advanced processor. Nothing big there. But I had to charge it. And when you first get the wireless grid, you have to sync it to your controller. So when you first get it, make sure you come here and in your hand, shift right click that or that. It's gonna be the bottom one. It's already synced though, so it won't show you. But it's going to sync to this block, and you want to sync it up to this. So when you open this, it opens your controller. You also need a wireless transmitter, and it's also pretty easy to make. Pretty much the same things. And you want to place your wireless transmitter anywhere on a piece of cable. I place mine right behind my controller or my crafting, what do you call this? I placed it right here in this area, just as the central point of contact. I also put the maximum number of upgrades in here. It's called range upgrades. Those guys are kind of expensive, but they're more of a pain to make. First thing you have to do is put these items to make the upgrade, which does nothing. You then get the upgrade with these two items and your solderer to make a range upgrade. I needed four of those. No big deal, right? Well, to charge this wireless grid, I need a wireless charger. And I'm trying to find where I put it. I don't know where I put it. I hid it somewhere. Oh, here it is, right here in the ground. It charges my grid automatically once it's plugged up and attached to power. But the wireless charger charges anything in your nearby player's inventories. The wireless charger was the one I had to build this slice and spice for. This is easy. This is easy. It's just, you know, going to your alloy smelter. I made tons of that already. But the Ender Resonator, you got to build a slice and splice. In it, you got to put an axe and some shears. It requires solarium, which is why I made that automatically. Silicone, vibrant alloy, and an Enderman head. Vibrant alloy is also made in your alloy smelter. We did that before too. Ender Resonator. Well, I haven't got that automated yet. I haven't figured it out yet, so I had to make it by hand. I have a pattern, but it just didn't work. I don't know why. I also put the upgrade in it. And it made the item for me. And that's when I placed it down here. But the slice and spice, how hard was that to build? Was that hard? Alice? No. This wasn't too bad either. You can use any head you want here with the machine chassis, solarium, and of course the shears and the axe. And that's that. So, yeah, I want to show y'all before I got too far ahead. The coolest thing about this was the fact that I had to put a chest down because I was having some problems. I lost power and I couldn't use my crafting station anymore because I unplugged the power. What else is there? I made something else over here. I doubt it's running. Where is it? This is a nifty tool. It's called a rain shield. And basically when it rains, in about a 32 to 64 radius around this rain shield, and I have two of them, it will light up and no longer will it rain in my base. So it won't rain the base anymore. I put one more over here to kind of cover both areas of the base. It pretty much, this one here pretty much covers all the way to about right here. So I could have moved this one way back here if I wanted to, but I put it just outside the coverage. But so the coverage is from about here all the way over there. So it really pretty much covers the entire base. It's not on right now because it's not raining. When it's on, you have like four fiery things come out the sides of it. It's pretty cool. And if you haven't made a rain shield, do it today. There's no reason not to have it. Let me show you why I say that. This is it. Three netherrack, one blaze rod, and a flint. If you're, a blaze rod, once you hit the nether and you hit the first fortress, you get those. If you get the chickens going on, you get that. Loot bags, drop it. Netherrack is also easy to make. You just drop redstone in a lava bucket and you get it. So there's really almost no excuses to have not to have a rain shield if you don't want one. Not day one or two, of course, but you know, once you're decently progressed, probably 30 days in, you can probably make one. Is that all that I've done? I think so. This was a lot of hours to get everything moved and replaced. But overall, I'm liking how the base is coming. I'm still doing some more cosmetic stuff again. I want to move all of these. That's going to be very painstakingly slow. I have to make a lot of those movers. I always forget what they're called. We can sort this area here. Just normal. Sort by quantity. The chest transporters. Make a diamond one. You get multiple uses out of it. And diamonds should be cheap around day 100 or so. The wooden ones break after one use. And they're cheap too. I'll show you how to make those. The diamond one is just like this, and it lasts quite a bit. The wooden one's very basic, but it only lasts one time. So I'm not sure about the rest. I'm sure they have much different values of use, but I just made a diamond because I had it. In fact, I probably got it in a loot bag, to be honest with you. But yeah, I'm gonna move all this stuff from up here. I'm gonna take this pipe, move it down, but it's just gonna be such a slow process. I'm not sure where it's gonna go yet. I'm thinking I'm gonna place them all across this wall here and maybe have a narrow walkway. Have it on both sides. That way it's all kind of centralized. And I think that's about it. I don't think I missed anything. I hope I didn't. I'll show you behind this wall just so you can see what's back here. So we don't take my word against yours, whatever. Let me get up in here. There. It's kind of hard to mine when, really? How low down is this stuff? Okay, I thought it was like right here. All right, here it is. So, like we had before, it's the same block of uranium and the crucible making melting the cobblestone into lava. I just hid it all behind here because I didn't want to see it anymore. And like I said, there's no reason to get back here anymore to do anything with this stuff because it's all self-contained and it's never going to go away. I wanted to show you just so you can kind of see what's going on back here. Nice and guarded for no reason other than just for aesthetics. I just don't want to be looking at all this stuff all day long. That's why I wanted it all in here. And I think that covers everything. So that's just a quick run through what we did, how we built it, what I built. I really hope I explained, even if I was wrong half the time, what I did and how I did it. This wrench, you gotta make the wrench. I'll show you the wrench real quick. It's very simple. It's just a quarter wrench iron and a basic processor, and that's the basic processor. It's this wrench right, no, this wrench right here. This is used for refined storage. This is used for your Ender IO wiring. And so that's it. So I'm gonna have more batteries placed down later just for storage and conversions. I'm gonna keep the 640, I think, coming back here. I might upgrade to the next level up for that one loop because it's got so much stuff on it. It does 5,000 a tick versus 640. It's not expensive, honestly. It's only like one reach it higher, and you can reuse your same pipe when you make it. So I may run all this stuff down back here with the 5,000. That will give me a good flow. Going this way, 640 should be all I need. But if I wanted to, I could also run the more advanced power through here. The solderers don't need power. I can run the more advanced power all the way to here, put a battery somewhere else out here. Honestly, there's really the batteries are nice because they're gonna store excess power for use anytime I need it. And it's wireless. So I mean there's no reason to have them. I can just pick it up when I'm done with it and put it somewhere else and just use it for power for anything else. I can actually put it right here and not run a power line if I didn't want to. Which now that I think about it, that's what I'll probably do. All right, well, this is this and that is that. We're gonna wrap this up. I don't know what I'm gonna do next. I've got a few ideas where I'm gonna try and tackle. I may do the, oh, look at, you caught it. So here it is. This is going off, but there's no rain. It looks rainy, but there's no rain. If we leave the area, it's now raining. And right about here is where it stops. Pretty good range, huh? I'm glad it started raining for you guys to see that. And it looks pretty vicious, but I don't think you take damage. Nope, no damage. It just looks cool. It's a rain shield. Very neat. And yeah, I'm rambling. I apologize for that. I'm just trying to make sure I didn't forget anything that I did. So, three crafters, each with eight unique crafting slots, going to solderers. I will build patterns for all that. Maybe. You'll find out why I said maybe later. I'm gonna try and get this license splice automated. I don't know why it's not. I'm trying to figure that out. It may be just the way the inputs and outputs are sitting. I'm pulling from there, but it's not pulling for some reason. I'm pushing. Well, I don't really have an output, do I? Well, I don't have an output. But it wasn't going in the input either. So it should have been. I don't know. And these two things are kind of weird. It could be why it was breaking. I don't know how to make the pattern, perhaps. I tried a few different ways and just couldn't make it work. I don't want to keep burning through heads because I was in the Enderman. So again, the processing pattern encoder is only to make things you can't craft by hand. So all your alloys and stuff, your furnace items, things like that. Your crafting area will show you things you can craft. If you already have them crafted, it won't show you. I'm not going to pull 2,000 sticks out of here. There's other filters you can make where you can change your settings, where you can always auto-craft certain things at all well, sometimes. I haven't looked into those yet, so I don't know how to do that yet. That's it. I'm not going to ramble anymore. Thanks for watching, everybody. I will catch you guys next time. And we might be discussing reborn storage. I don't know. We might be. Have a good night and take care. Bye-bye.